Hello everyone, and welcome to 6.5, Neurons and Synapses. Today, we're actually going to look at how nerves work, which will give us a little bit of insight about how we control our bodies, and about what's really going on inside of our brains. So, let's get started. First off, in these pictures, you can actually see some nerve cells. Now, this is actually a cross-section of something similar to the spine, a nerve bundle. So I'll get back to those pictures in just a sec. First off, nerve cells are called neurons. A neuron is a nerve cell, and neurons transmit information by using electrical impulses. So the nervous system itself is composed of neurons, and it has two main parts, the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. Again, all of these are made by neurons which are carrying electrical impulses. Now, the central nervous system is your brain and spinal cord. So your spine actually does control parts of your body. For example, some things to do with breathing are actually located in your spine, and some reflex decisions will actually be made right in there. Now, your central nervous system are protected by your brain and spinal cord. And it your central nervous system is protected by bone. And it receives signals from the rest of your body. The rest of your body has the peripheral nervous system, which is all the neurons that are not in your central nervous system. So these peripheral nerves control your organs, your muscles, and they receive signals from your sensors. So, what does a neuron look like? Here's a picture of a neuron, and in a nutshell, neurons have a cell body. And this part looks like any other normal animal cell. There's a nucleus, there's the cytoplasm, there'll be a rough endoplasmic reticulum in there with mitochondria, etc., etc., etc. However, neurons have these big arms. The arms on one side of it are called dendrites, and on the other side, we have the axon, this super long projection of the cell membrane. The dendrites are going to be receiving signals. And the axon is what the neuron will use to send a signal. So again, the cell body is where most of the cytoplasm is and all the organelles. You can sometimes, when you're drawing this, you only get the point if you include the nucleus. So make sure you draw the nucleus in there too. Around the cell body, we have dendrites, which provide a large surface area for connecting with other neurons. And they only send signals back towards the cell body. They receive information. The thing that sends information is called the axon. And the axon is super long. An axon is only about 10 micrometers in diameter, which is tiny. However, they can be up to 4 meters long. That's in whales, by the way. A piece of spaghetti the same length would have about a diameter of about 1 millimeter, but be about 400 meters long. That's 4 professional football courts. And these axons carry nerve impulses away from the cell body. Growing around the axon, we have something called a Schwann cell. So, let me quickly show you a little video of a Schwann cell, so you see what I mean by growing around. Now, so, as you saw, a Schwann cell wraps around the axon and creates this thick layer, essentially a fat, around it. This fat is called myelin. And just like a sheath is what you keep a sword in, this myelin is what the axon stays in. So it's called a myelin sheath, and it is grown by a Schwann cell. The myelin sheath is fatty, and that resists electricity. So it helps keep the electric transmission in the axon and can actually increase the speed of nerve transmission by something called saltatory conduction. More on that later. Now between Schwann cells, there are little spaces called nodes of Ranvier. That's how you pronounce it in English, but Ranvier was actually French, so it should be nodes of Ranvier. Ranvier is fine. But anyway, these little nodes here are the spaces between two Schwann cells, and they allow electricity to jump from node to node. That's the saltatory conduction. So, all the way at the end, we're left with the last part, the axon terminal. So again, cell body, dendrite sticking out of it, long axon. When you're drawing this for IB mark schemes, the axon has to be at least 3 times longer than the cell body is wide. So cell body, axon has to be at least 3 times longer. And growing around the axon, you have these Schwann cells, which are covered in myelin. Between the Schwann cells, you have nodes of Ranvier. So, a quick video on this.
The nervous system, the brain, spinal cord, and nerves, is a living communications network, carrying various kinds of messages to and from the different parts of your body. The nervous system is composed of nerve fibers that conduct information into your spinal cord and brain, and the other nerve fibers that send information out to different parts of your body. The cells that make up the various parts of the nervous system are called neurons. Each neuron has a neuron body, a part of the cell which contains a nucleus and other structures. But a typical neuron has two other kinds of structures. Long fibers that extend in different directions from the body of the cell. These fibers are often wrapped with a fatty substance called myelin. Fibers that carry impulses toward the neuron body are called dendrites. Fibers that carry impulses away are called axons. The spinal cord is a long cylinder of nerve tissue that passes through the hollow channels of bones called the vertebrae. The spinal cord is protected by those vertebrae.
Now, one axon, an axon terminal, will meet the dendrite of another nerve cell. The space between the axon of one nerve and the dendrite of the next is called a synapse. A synapse is where two neurons meet. Now, the actual space between them is the synaptic cleft. A cleft is when you cut something, so that makes sense. And a chemical signal is going to have to move from the axon of one neuron to the dendrite of the next one, across the synaptic cleft. So here you can actually see a dendrite, and you'll notice that every projection is actually connected to an axon. So these neurons are all completely connected to one another. And when the signal reaches the end, you can see here how at the axon terminal, these little vesicles containing chemicals called neurotransmitters will be released by exocytosis to diffuse across the synaptic cleft to be detected by the next dendrite, or receptors on the dendrites. So let me show you a little video of this sort of interconnectedness that's happening inside your nervous system.
The axon terminal contains vesicles of substances known as neurotransmitters. On the postsynaptic dendrite are specific receptors which chemically bind with neurotransmitter molecules. When an axon terminal is depolarized by an action potential, calcium-specific channels in the membrane open, allowing calcium ions to diffuse inside rapidly. The influx of calcium triggers the fusion of vesicles to the membrane, releasing neurotransmitters into the synaptic cleft. The neurotransmitter molecules diffuse across and bind to the receptors on the postsynaptic dendrite.
Now, let's actually talk about how a nerve impulse is sent. Two big words that you really need to know for this: action potential, depolarization, repolarization, and resting potential. So sorry, that's four big words you really have to know. Let's start with the two potentials. Normally, when a nerve cell is resting, it has a resting potential or charge of negative 70 millivolts. So when a nerve cell is not sending a signal, it has a negative charge. It's actually negative 70. When it's in the middle of sending a signal, that part of the axon, not the whole cell, but just where the signal is, if you picture a wave of electricity going down the axon, the peak of that wave is where the action is happening. and that's the action potential. And you can follow an action potential along an axon. Now, the action potential actually has a positive charge of about plus 30. And the peak of that wave moves along the nerve, starting at a dendrite, moving to the cell body, and moving all the way down an axon. Now, when you're going from a resting potential up to an action potential, that's called depolarization. And it's the change from negative to positive. So this is how you go from a resting potential to an action potential. Repolarization is how you get the nerve cell ready once again. So for repolarization, it's when you go from the peak of the action potential back down to the resting potential. So to do all this, nerves use two ions, sodium and potassium. There's this one pump that pumps sodium out of the cell and potassium into the cell. It is a protein pump, so it uses ATP. This is active transport. And it pumps 3 sodiums out for every 2 potassiums pumped in. Now, because more positive charge is being pumped out than being pumped in, against diffusion, this creates a resting potential, the normal charge of the neuron of negative 70 millivolts. So a normal neuron that's not doing action potential, that's just relaxing, is at negative 70 millivolts and has no sodium inside and is filled with potassium. So how can you remember that a neuron wants to keep sodium out and potassium in? Well, the letters for sodium is Na. The letter for potassium is K. So does a resting neuron want sodium? Nah, it does not. Nah, it does not. Does it want potassium? K, it does. In resting potential, a neuron does not want sodium and wants potassium. Use the letters to remember that. So, here's a quick video of how that pumping works.
Animal cells store energy in the form of ion gradients across the cell membrane. In the cytosol, the sodium ion concentration is kept low relative to the extracellular fluid, and conversely, the potassium ion concentration in the cytosol is kept high. Like water behind a dam, these gradients harbor potential energy that the cell taps to fuel cellular work. Animal cells use a membrane pump, called the sodium-potassium pump, to maintain these ion gradients. To begin the pumping cycle, sodium ions enter binding sites on the cytosolic side of the pump. Although there are 3 sodium binding sites on this pump, for simplicity, only one is illustrated here. Pumping sodium against its concentration gradient requires energy, which is provided by cleaving ATP. ATP transfers a phosphate group to the pump in a high-energy linkage. Phosphorylation causes a dramatic change in the pump's conformation, so that the sodium ions become exposed and released outside of the cell. This action also exposes binding sites for potassium ions in the pump. Although there are 2 potassium binding sites, for simplicity, only one is shown here. Binding of the potassium ions triggers release of the phosphate group and the return of the pump to its initial conformation. The potassium is then released inside the cell, and the cycle repeats. A complete cycle takes about 10 milliseconds.
So, nerve impulses are action potentials that travel along the axon. Remember, think of an action potential like a wave going along the axon. So the way it starts is when sodium channels open. Now, because so much sodium has been pumped out of the axon, by diffusion, all the sodium wants to go from area of high concentration outside to the area of low concentration inside. So it rushes down its concentration gradient. And because the axon is already filled with positive potassium, now that it's filled with positive sodium and positive potassium, it goes all the way up to a plus 30 charge. That's called depolarization, and that's what happens for the action potential. And so, That's the peak of the wave of charge. Right after that happens, the sodium channels close and potassium channels open. The potassium channels allow potassium to move by diffusion from its area of high concentration inside the axon to the area of low concentration outside the axon. So much potassium moves out that it restores the resting potential of negative 70 millivolts. So, if I'm looking at just one slice of an axon, the axon here is normally at its resting potential of negative 70 millivolts. First, this is maintained by pumping sodium out and potassium in. Then, the sodium channels open and sodium rushes in, depolarizing the axon, that section of it, reaching an action potential. Then, sodium channels close, potassium channels open, potassium rushes out, repolarizing the neuron. Then, the sodium and the potassium are in the wrong place. Sodium's inside and potassium's outside now. So it takes a few hundredths of a second to pump them back to where they should be. During that time, no more signals can be sent. So that's the amount of time between two signals in a neuron. And that's called a refractory period. Once that's over, we're back to the resting potential. So let me show you a quick animation of this. Here, we can see it. So again, we're looking at just one section of an axon. First, the sodium-potassium pump pumps sodium out and potassium in at negative 70 millivolts. Then the sodium channel opens, so sodium rushes in down its concentration gradient, depolarizing the neuron to the action potential. Then potassium channels open, so all the potassium rushes out, repolarizing the neuron. Now that they're at the wrong place, there's a little lag while the pump puts them all where they need to be to return to resting potential. That's how it works. So, remember that we're just looking at one slice of an axon, which is sending the signal. This actually starts in the dendrite, moves all the way across the cell body and down the axon to the axon terminal. So if I look at a slice of one axon, when it's at resting potential, there's lots of potassium inside the axon, no potassium outside. So what happens is some sodium comes in here when the sodium channels open. Now this sodium diffuses both directions along the axon. As it goes this direction, in the direction of the impulse, here, it starts to depolarize the part of the axon further along. Now, that means that right here, where it's negative, where my mouse is, it's starting to get a little bit more positive. So, you might have noticed in some of the graphs that there's this dotted green line. When you reach negative 40 millivolts, that's what makes sodium channels open. That's the threshold. That's the minimum level, because the sodium channels are actually triggered by a charge. So, when you reach negative 40 millivolts, because some of this sodium is diffusing up the axon, the sodium channels open, and sodium rushes in. Some sodium diffuses on the side either way, and that causes more sodium channels to open in front, moving the action potential, where it's positive, all the way along the axon. Now, even though sodium is diffusing backwards, it never reaches the threshold here. And even if it did, and sodium channels opened, the axon is already filled with sodium, so an action potential cannot go backwards. That's why it's so important that all the sodium's in there, and you restore the negative by potassium leaving. If you restored the negative by pumping out sodium again, then some sodium may just diffuse backwards and cause the channel to open and start all over again. And you really want the signal to only be able to go in one direction. So, Let's look at a quick video of all of this happening.
A nerve impulse is an electrical current that travels along dendrites or axons due to ions moving through voltage-gated channels in the neuron's plasma membrane. Voltage-gated channels open and close in response to an electrical voltage, so they are affected by changes in electrical charge around them. When a neuron is at rest, a charge difference is maintained between the inside and outside of the cell. This charge difference is produced and maintained largely by active transport using sodium-potassium pumps. The pumps send sodium ions out of the cell and bring potassium ions in. While other channels allow some flow of potassium ions back out of the cell, the sodium ions cannot easily get back in to replace the lost positive charges. The overall result is that the exterior of the cell has a net positive charge and the interior has a net negative charge. The difference in charge between the interior and exterior of the cell is called the resting membrane potential. A nerve impulse begins when a stimulus disturbs the plasma membrane on a dendrite, causing sodium channels to open. Sodium ions flow into the cell, lessening the charge difference at that location. If the change is enough, it will cause nearby voltage-gated sodium channels to open. This allows so many sodium ions to flood into the cell at that location that the membrane there is depolarized, with the local region inside the cell having a net positive charge and the outside of the cell having a net negative charge. This affects neighboring voltage-gated sodium channels, which then open, moving the depolarization along the membrane. This moving depolarization is called an action potential. Changes occur behind the action potential to restore the resting membrane potential. The voltage-gated sodium channels close and voltage-gated potassium channels open. This allows a rapid flow of potassium ions out of the cell, repolarizing the membrane so that the inside is again negative and the outside positive. This is followed by use of sodium-potassium pumps to fully restore the resting membrane potential and to re-establish proper concentrations of sodium and potassium ions inside and outside the cell.
So, that was how action potentials work, nerve impulses moving along a neuron. Now, the propagation of the nerve impulse is the result of these local currents that cause successive parts of the axon to reach the threshold potential. That threshold, somewhere between minus 50 and minus 30, depending on your source, but I say around minus 40 millivolts, is the amount needed to open the sodium channels. Opening these sodium channels will cause the next section of the axon to depolarize a little as sodium diffuses forward, moving the action potential down the axon. Now, again, if we're looking at just one part of an axon, one slice of an axon, it's normally at resting potential. Some sodium starts diffusing into this section of the axon, so it starts getting more and more positive over time until it reaches the threshold level, which causes the sodium channels to open. So this section of the axon depolarizes all the way up to the action potential of positive 30 millivolts. Sodium channels close, potassium channels open, repolarization all the way down to actually about negative 80 millivolts. Potassium channels closed, the sodium channels are still closed, the sodium-potassium pump switches the sodium and the potassium, pumping sodium out. Do you want it? Nah. Pumping potassium in. Do you want it? Okay. Returning to the resting potential. This time that it takes to do that is the refractory period. It's the time it needs to restore the balance of sodium to potassium normally. And this keeps the action potential from going backwards. So another video on this.
The fundamental task of a nerve cell is to receive, conduct, and transmit signals. Neurons propagate signals in the form of action potentials, which can travel great distances along an axon without weakening. To transmit an action potential over such a distance without weakening requires that the signal is continuously reamplified along the way. The central molecular players in this process are the voltage-gated sodium channels, which undergo a cycle of finely choreographed conformational changes. When an action potential passes, sodium channels open in response to membrane depolarization. Sodium ions rush into the axon, further depolarizing its membrane. Within a fraction of a thousandth of a second, however, the sodium channels switch to a new inactivated state, in which they are closed, but now also refractory to reopening. In this way, the membrane potential can recover quickly after an action potential has passed. The sodium channels then reconvert to the closed state, ready to be opened again when the next action potential is encountered. Let's examine the changing state of the sodium channel during an action potential. When no stimulus is present, the sodium channels remain closed, and the electrical potential measured across the membrane remains constant. However, if a depolarizing stimulus is applied by a brief pulse of electric current, the membrane will start to depolarize away from the resting potential of about minus 80 millivolts. Some of the sodium channels will open, permitting sodium ions to enter the axon along their concentration gradient. If the depolarization is sufficient, even more sodium channels open, and the membrane potential rapidly approaches the equilibrium potential for sodium, about plus 40 millivolts. At this point, the sodium channels close, adopting the inactive conformation, where the channel is unable to open again even though the membrane potential is still depolarized. The sodium channels remain in this inactivated state until a few milliseconds after the membrane potential returns to its initial negative value. The action potential is propagated along the length of the axon in only one direction. By examining the membrane potential and state of the sodium channels along a length of the axon, we can see why this is so. As a depolarizing stimulus reaches our section of the membrane, sodium channels open and current flows into the axon. This in turn depolarizes adjacent sections of the membrane, causing adjacent sodium channels to open, and the action potential is thus propagated along the axon. Sodium channel inactivation prevents the depolarization from spreading backward along the axon.
So, sodium ions in the resting potential are concentrated outside the membrane. In the action potential, rush in to the axon. Potassium is normally inside the axon during resting potential, but rushes out of the axon right after the peak of the action potential. So, when we think of the ion channels during the resting potential, the sodium and potassium channels are open, but during depolarization going to the peak of the action potential, the sodium channels open first, then they close, then the potassium channels open before closing. However, protein pumps are always, specifically the sodium-potassium pump, is always pumping sodium out and potassium in against its concentration gradient using ATP to maintain the resting potential of about negative 70 millivolts. The action potential up to positive 30 millivolts happens when the sodium channels open, reversing the membrane potential. To return to the resting potential, the potassium channels open, restoring the negative 70 millivolts. So, a last quick video on this. Okay, so I've been showing you a graph over and over again, and this graph here that I've been showing is the result of a machine called an oscilloscope. To oscillate means a wave, and an oscilloscope measures electrical charges, so it allows us to see the resting potential and action potential. So again, an oscilloscope measures charges, and it always makes a graph with time in the x-axis and the electrical charge on the y-axis. So here's an oscilloscope, and here's the graph it makes. And from this graph, you can see the negative 70 millivolts. So what you normally take is you take this machine and you stick two probes into the axon, technically one right outside, one inside. And they don't move, they stay there. And they measure the charge right there in the neuron. Negative 70 during resting potential, as sodium diffuses into that part of the axon, increasing unto the threshold. Once it's at the threshold, depolarization happens as the sodium channels open, bringing us to action potential. Sodium channels close, potassium channels open, repolarization happens, going back down to about negative 80 millivolts. Now the sodium is inside, the potassium is outside, so it cannot do another action potential until the sodium is pumped outside by the sodium-potassium pump and the potassium is pumped in. That's called, the time it takes to do that is the refractory period until you return to the negative 70 millivolts of the resting potential. So the action potential normally lasts very, very short, 3 to 5 milliseconds, thousandths of a second. The resting potential is where it starts, then depolarization, then the action potential, then repolarization, followed by the refractory period. Now, this is what happens in an unmyelinated neuron. Remember those Schwann cells that are wrapped around the cell? They can actually make this happen faster by allowing electricity to jump around the cells rather than going all the way down the axon. This is called saltatory conduction. You don't really need to know how it happens, other than that it hops around the Schwann cells. Don't worry more than that. You need to be able to answer an 8-point question on how a nerve impulse moves along the axon, and you have to know that saltatory conduction can happen thanks to Schwann cells and is faster. Unmyelinated neurons have the action potential propagating all the way along the axon. Myelinated neurons have it hop between the gaps, called nodes of Ranvier, and it's 100 times faster. So you can see it hopping here. This is what saltatory conduction looks like versus the much slower normal conduction. The advantage of myelination, of course, you know, saltatory conduction, is that it's much, much faster. The disadvantage is that although Schwann cells take up a lot of extra space, so in some place like your brain, where you have the skull holding all your nerves in there, you can fit more nerves in if they're not myelinated without Schwann cells. And on top of that, 100 times faster makes a big difference over a long distance. But if the nerve is very short or if they're very close together, it doesn't make such a difference because sending the chemicals across the synaptic cleft between the axon terminal and the dendrite of the next neuron takes more time anyway. Now, by the way, myelinated axons appear as white matter, whereas the rest are gray matter. That's why some parts of the nervous system are considered gray matter, while others are white matter. In any case, I'm going to end there for today. Thanks for watching. Ciao.